To have Brother Grady with us, a dear friend. He's meant a lot in my life through these years, and I'm excited that we can hear him preach. Amen. Let's sing. Preston, why don't you come? Let's make a joyful noise together, brother. Preston, why don't you come?
All righty, let's stand for our first song. We'll turn to page 55. We'll sing all three verses of When the Roll is Called Up Yonder.
Hey.
Page 55.
Father, thank you, Lord, for that beautiful song, When That Roll is Called Up Yonder, Lord, and we'll be there. Lord, help us in these days we live, Lord, to stand, Lord, and Lord, help us to have done all to stand. Lord, thank you for this place. Thank you for the dear people that have come back tonight. This is better than any football game. This is bigger. This is life-changing. So, Lord, use the preaching. Speak to our hearts. Lord, we love you, and we ask this in your precious name. Amen. You may be seated. Went and saw Nevin, if you haven't heard. Betty went home to be with the Lord this morning at about between 7 and 8 o'clock. Got up there right as soon as I could after the service, and Nevin was there with Betty still in the room at 2 o'clock. And I told him I'd walk him to his car if he wanted to, and he wouldn't leave. He was going to stay there until they came to take Betty. So, but to see that dear saint who struggled for all these years, no more pain, no more suffering. So that motivates us, and ought to motivate us to keep pressing on. Amen. It was 24 years ago, almost 25 years ago, that we knocked this neighborhood. We weren't in this building. And we knocked that Betty's door, met the Moons within our first month of starting. And the Moons have been faithful members since then. So let's remember Nevin in prayer. But I think Nevin's going to need us in these days. They have no children. Nevin will be alone. So let's reach out to Nev. So it's a busy week. We have never before have we ever had three funerals in a week. We have three of them this week. We have Mary Sandoval's daughter. We have Micaiah's grandmother this week. and most likely the moons. So let's, amen. We got visitors coming in. Amen. Amen. All righty. So let's sing another song. Brother Grady's got some great books back there some deep truths. Amen. All right. Press, come. And then we'll take up the offering. Remember, we're going to, we have tonight, Monday night, and Tuesday night. Okay. So we're looking forward to it. Come, and we do. We need our hearts stirred. Amen. Press, why don't you come? Let's sing.
All right. We'll remain seated. We'll turn to page 178. And song we've been singing since Sunday school, but to me, it's probably one of the most amazing truths in the Bible, and that's that Jesus loves even me. So we'll turn to page 178. We'll sing all three verses.
Fellas, why don't you come on down? Amen. I'm so thankful you folks came back tonight. A wonderful morning. Seeing the couples with their little ones lined up here. I think we need to seriously give our all for Christ. He gave his all for us. Amen. Carl, why don't you come on up? Amen, Carl. Why don't you ask the Lord's blessing? I always feel safe when Carl's around. Amen. So guy with a big beard like that. Amen. Because he's so scary looking. Amen. Brother, why don't you pray?
Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for this day. I thank you for the church services this morning. And I thank you for all those that were able to make it back tonight. Thank you for bringing Brother Grady here safely. I pray that we could be a blessing to him as much as he will be to us. Just bless this offering, bless the time together with your people. We love you and thank you and ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, brother.
Thank you.
Alrighty, let's stand for our final song. We'll turn to page 343. We'll sing the first, the second, and the last of Revive Us Again. Page 343. Thank you for today, Lord, and I thank you for everybody who made it tonight, and I pray that you'd be with Brother Grady as he speaks to us tonight, Lord. I thank you for his safe travels on the way here, and thank you for him being willing to come and meet with us, Lord. I thank you for that, and pray that you'd, again, give him the words as he speaks and just fill him with your power, Lord. I pray that you'd open up hearts tonight, Lord, and be receptive to what you're impressing upon us, Lord. We love you and thank you for all that you do. You know my prayer. Amen.
Amen. Amen. I'll tell you, when you get a little older, your mind goes back to earlier days. I remember being a young man, Bible college, and the highlight of all the chapels in the 2 years I was at Hiles Anderson, the highlight chapels were the man you're going to hear tonight. I mean that. The truth, the humility, the I like that Brother Grady always went against the grain a little bit, but he was an encouragement in my life and told me truths and encouraged me when very few others would have thought of that. But Brother Grady, I consider you a dear friend, and we get to inherit the pleasure to have Brother Grady with us. Brother Grady's had his heartaches. He said goodbye to his boy in a tragic accident. And it's amazing how life has a way of humbling us. I was talking to Preston years ago, Sunday, the games meant so much. Amen. A football game and who wins and all that, it's true. The things of this earth become strangely dim.
Amen.
I walked away, the Packer game doesn't even faze me. Doesn't even inkle on my radar much anymore. So today, let's let God. I believe society is a mess, but do you think God could revive our hearts? I believe he could. That we could keep rowing the boat. Seeing God do something right here in our hearts. Amen. Brother Grady, why don't you come? Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Well, I'm glad he didn't have a clip on Mike to start putting on my tie, and these preachers get like 2 inches from my face. I don't want a man that close to me. Especially when he's talking about turning me on. I don't need that. Praise God. Well, I'm glad to be back here in the land of nowhere. It is a crazy place, this town. I'm telling you, neighbor. He's right about this. When I was at Hiles Anderson, Wendell Evans, who was the president of the college, when I went up there to teach, anybody remember Welcome Back, Carter? Crazy. That's when I came back to teach in my old alma mater. And Dr. Evans used to say to me, preacher, Brother Bill, or Brother Bill, you're a seer. A seer, you know what I mean, the word seer from the Old Testament, another word for a prophet, a seer. Brother Bill, you're a seer. This college needs seers. That's what he always said. Everything was okay until I started seeing things. Amen. Can't make that stuff up. All right, well, I'm glad to be here. I was in Plymouth this morning and Calico Rock, Arkansas, Wednesday, and Branson, Missouri, Sunday before that, and somewhere else, Massillon, Ohio, the Wednesday before that. I've got three stops in Wisconsin after I finish here, then I get to go home. So I stay running around like a crazy person, and I appreciate your pastor. Your pastor's a great guy. I mean, I have a lot of respect for him. And so I must tell you my newest Italian joke. Is that okay? So you heard about that groundhog in Pennsylvania, Punxsutawney Phil, what's his name? I can never pronounce that dude's name, Punxsutawney Phil. They see a shadow, there's another 6 weeks or something of winter, right? Well, there's an Italian groundhog in Philadelphia. His name is Philly Bruno. And they asked him if he saw his shadow, right? And he said, I didn't see nothing. Isn't that a good joke? You know, I must tell you this too. So I was in Montreal, Canada, I don't know, 6 months ago, preaching for two different churches. And in the one church preacher, there were two converted gangsters on my right side here. I mean, two Montreal wise guys, the real thing. They used to be pushing heroin all over the country, and they both got saved. And they're both Italians. And so I was, of course, I'm thinking about switching to Polack jokes that night. But the preacher that, you know, that they were sitting under, you know, everything reproduces after its own kind. You hear that, right? Well, the preachers agreed, Peter Kyriopoulos, but he was a big drug dealer before he was saved. His nickname all over Montreal was Peter the Pitchfork, because that's what he used for a weapon when the Haitians would try to steal his drugs, fight him off with a pitchfork. He got saved, and now he's able to lead the pastor these two mafia dudes. But so I took a chance there preaching. I told my joke. What's a good four-letter Italian word for goodbye? Everybody thinks it's ciao. You've heard that, ciao. Yeah. Well, no, the real punchline is bang. See? So I told that there like a trial balloon, and they were laughing their heads off. Of course, I knew they would laugh. You got to be a Pharisee Baptist to have a problem with Italian jokes. So after the service, though, the one of them told the preacher, he said, you know, that Dr. Grady's a cool guy, but he had that joke all messed up. He said, it's never bang. It's always a minimum bang, bang, sometimes bang, bang, bang. And the sick part was he wasn't being funny. He was just trying to help me out. Like, you know, somebody finds a mistake in a book. Page 13, has it got a number there wrong? But the other one was even crazier than him. The preacher told me later that the preacher, had tried to teach the other dude, they're both Italian Catholics, you know, teach the other guy about the Bible. And he's teaching him the Old Testament sacrifice system where the priest would cut the animals up, you know. Sometimes the blood would splatter on the priest's vestments. The other guy said it as serious as it could be. Well, that's why we always would use plastic. It's serious as a heart attack. All right, so anyway, blah, blah, blah. I'll be here, Lord willing, three nights, so I don't have to make a big push today because only one service. But a lot of you have my books already from before, the last few times. I hope you'll do me one favor. More important than buying a book is if you would read the one you have. If you will read this book, since I was here last time, things have got 10 times crazier out there. And I deal with all that stuff in here. And if you want more, that red book back there, 900 pages, you know, How Satan Turned America Against God. That's the conspiracy primer. I believe we went to the moon, amen? And I believe the earth is round. Amen. And I believe Sandy Hook was real. But I got a 900-page book back there filled with real conspiracies that are going on right now. But this book here is a little smaller. And this will blow your mind. Hey, I was just talking to the preacher. What they call it is Mayo down here. Let me read you one quote from page 39 here. These medical dissenters and whistleblowers have been willing to lay it on the line. In other words, these medical people that wouldn't take the shot and wouldn't go along with the routine six, were willing to lay it on the line, paying a hefty price to guard their patients. The price they paid, ridicule, slander, censorship, gag orders, blacklisting, litigation termination, license revocation, forfeiture of retirement and related financial packages, et al. For example, in the first week of 2022, the sacrosanct Mayo Clinic turned 700 former heroes into zeros. You know, the first responders and the medical people, because they risked their lives helping save the lives of people, everybody loved them until they tried to jam this vaccination on them. Turned 700 former heroes into zeros by issuing them pink slips for refusing their chemical cocktails. By then, some 20% of the nation's medical personnel, nearly a half million, had either quit or were fired from their positions. Now, that's just one little sentence of mine from page 39. It's the chapter on the vaccines and the whole COVID mess called Inventors. Title of the chapter, Inventors of Evil Things. That comes out of Romans 1:18. By the way, your preacher updated me. I just wrote about the first week. He said, and overall, did you say 10,000?
Well, either took early retirement or fired.
Yeah, 10,000. So I feel your pain in a way. I don't live here, but I know you're affected by that. You lost some good church people here. Well, you ought to know what's going on. Charles Spurgeon said, visit many books, but live in the Bible. You don't give up your Bible, but you don't just stick to the Bible only. God's not interested in you not learning when you can learn other things that are relevant to what's in the Bible, right? Spurgeon said, if any man who refuses to use the brains of other men proves he has no brains of his own. Brethren, you need to read. So again, a lot of you have the books, but I sure hope you don't just buy it for doorstop. Hope you read it, okay? Blah, blah, blah. So if you don't have it, though, make sure you get one. I'll be here three nights, and all the books there are discounted. They're all $20 or three for 50. This is 25. The three big ones back there are 30 if you look at the price tag. We sell them all day long out of Knoxville, Tennessee at retail, plus shipping. Get them here at a good discount. Widow ladies, if you don't have my new book, you get a free one from me. And blah, blah, blah. Look, I take bad checks. I'll take debit cards. I'll take somebody else's debit card. If you get your hands on it, come on, talk to me. You're killing me, Smalls. All right, so enough of all that. There's six books on the table. We'll talk more about it maybe as the week goes on. But that's very important that you see that. Now, I got some unbelievably good material, new material. I don't know where I'm going, but I mean, we won't have a dull moment here between now and Wednesday or Tuesday, okay? So plan on coming back and bring some visitors. Have you got your Bible? Turn over to Peter, 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter 2. Where's 1 Peter? Somebody help me here.
Before 2 Peter.
Huh?
Before 2 Peter.
Okay. That's a lot of help. 1 Peter 2.
James.
All right, you got your Bible open to 1 Peter 2? Why don't we stand for the reading of God's Word, give you a seventh inning stretch. If you're an extra big giver and you prefer to sit, preacher won't mind, I'm sure. One verse. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24. Well, let's go back up and read a few verses leading into that for context's sake. Verse 21. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow his steps, who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth, who, when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously. Here's the verse for tonight's message. Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the what? Tree. That we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. Brother Nate, you got, can you pray on the spur of the minute?
Yes.
Little Nate, huh?
Yes.
All right. By the way, I'm going to be real serious in a moment about trees, but there is one Italian joke I should tell you. How many of you know why Italians can't count to 10? Because every time they get to 2, they run into a tree. Okay, I'm giving Nate some time to think up a prayer back there. All right, Nate.
Dear Father, Lord, I thank you for everyone that's here tonight. And I pray you give Brother Gray as he speaks to us. And I thank you for his willingness to come here and preach to us. And I pray you have listening ears, Lord. And I pray you just work in our hearts. And thank you for this day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated.
Amen.
When I was a little dweeb, I grew up in New York. Some of you know my testimony, I guess. And my apartment in Manhattan was just like the Honeymooners. Anybody ever see Ralph and Norton? What that place looked like, it could have been my apartment, the icebox, the window, the fire escape, screaming outside the window. It was crazy. And when I was just a little kid, my mother, who killed herself when I was 11 years old, so this is when I was under 11, I can't remember what year, she mesmerized me by reading a poem. Many times she would read this poem. It was written by a man named Joyce Kilmer. It was written in 1913. And it was called Tree. Some of you old timers now will remember some of these things. Let me read it to you. I mean, it hypnotized me. I'm in a nasty concrete jungle. 7 million people, 38,000 people per square mile. I remember being on the street with a Hungarian friend of mine. Went to a Hungarian Catholic school, St. Stephen's of Hungary. I was with this Hungarian dude, John Gases. We're just walking down 2nd Avenue in Manhattan, and I saw a blade of grass sticking out of a crack in the cement. And I looked at that. And my friend said, "Hey, look, Bill, we're out in the country today." Anybody ever remember that crazy song by the Drifters, "Up on the Roof"?
Yeah.
That was written about New York culture. We wouldn't go all the way out to Jones Beach or Rockaway or Coney Island. We didn't want to mess around. We went up on the roof of our apartments. They call that Tar Beach. That's where that song came from. Up on the roof. Everybody go up there, put the blankets out, turn the radio on, sunglasses kick back, Heyer's root beer. I can see the bottle right next to it. They're in the beach. Read it, listen to the song. And then when it's too hot up there, you go under the boardwalk. Same, you know, it's part two of the song. So anyway, let me read you this poem that my mother read to me when I was a child. I think that I shall never see a poem as lovely as a tree. A tree whose hungry mouth is pressed against the earth's sweet flowing breast. A tree that looks at God all day and lifts her leafy arms to pray. A tree that may in summer wear a nest of robins in her hair, upon whose bosom snow has lain, who intimately lives with rain. Now, most of you should know the ending of the poem, you older people. Poems are made by fools like me. Anybody remember the ending? But only God can make a tree. My mother used to take me to Central Park in Manhattan all the time as a child. I lived within walking distance. I was so glad to grow up there. I saw squirrels, pigeons, you know, ducks on 3 or 4 lakes in the park, you know. You ever see Judge Judy? You know, in the opening scene, you see those sailboats on that little lake? That's Sailboat Lake. I grew up goofing off. The first fish I ever caught, Nate, I got a screen, look, like a mosquito screen, folded it up on 4 sides, put string on each corner, you know, tied all 4 strings together so I could have my own homemade nest. And I went in there, man, and some hippie teenagers next to me smoking. I'm just about 10 years old. And they're dumping their ashes on the water, and the guppies coming after the ashes. I pulled the thing up, caught me a bunch of guppies, put them in a little Coca-Cola cup, took them home, amen. Put them in my fish tank, and my sister's Angora cat, Susie, you know, cleaned them all out and ate them all. Precious memories. How many don't give a flip? Be honest with them. Tell you this. You know, I had three turtles, Huey, Dewey, and Louie. For real. One died, my mother flushed it down the toilet. The other one, though, she opened up the window, look, and flung it like a rock, like you're skipping a stone, you know, open a window. Hey, I told you, Ralph and Norton's apartment, I could see my mother in my mind's eye now, memory, with a broom, you know, smashing the ceiling with the broom handle. When neighbors were too noisy up there. Knocked three times on the pipe. That's what we would do. We had a problem with the super, bang on the pipe. Super had to come up and fix whatever's wrong. Precious memories. My mother wrote a poem, though, about our back alley outside the window. Open the window. Let me tell you the poem she wrote. In my yard, there grows a tree. It has no name or pedigree. On its boughs, there are no nests. For down below, the felines rest. Joyce Kilmer was born December the 6th, 1886, the man who wrote that poem, in New Brunswick, New Jersey. His father was Dr. Frederick Barnett Kilmer, a physician and an analytical chemist who worked for Johnson & Johnson Company. Anybody ever have your butt powdered with Johnson's baby powder when you were little? Joyce Kilmer's dad is the guy that invented it. And if you ever had Johnson's baby powder, you might be open for a class action lawsuit. Clavicle cancer, they're dying like flies right now from that powder.
Yeah.
Check it out, man. Debbie Downer's up here talking the other day. Joyce Kilmer was educated at Rutgers University. Now, you know I'm going somewhere with this. He was educated at Rutgers University in New Jersey. His first poetry book was published in 1911 when he was 25 years of age. 2 years later, he published Trees. He and his wife, Aline, had 5 children. In April 1917, he enlisted in the 7th Regiment of the New York National Guard. Now that's the iconic Irish Brigade. You've heard of it, known as the Fighting 69th. There was a movie in 1940, maybe some of you remember it, with James Cagney and Pat O'Brien, The Fighting 69th. In New York, it's the Catholic capital of the United States, and there's all so much propaganda. The St. Patrick's Day Parade is the longest parade in America. Goes on for about 5.5-6 hours. Big propaganda campaign. During the Second Battle of the Marne in World War I, Kilmer volunteered to accompany Major Wild Bill Donovan on a dangerous mission. Now, some of you should know that name. Donovan is the man that, after World War II, began the OSS, Office of Strategic Services, which morphed into the CIA. I have an uncle that I'm named after, William F. Grady, my father's brother. He was in the Navy, he was in the Merchant Marines, and he was in the Coast Guard. And during World War II, he was torpedoed as a merchant marine off the coast of Murmansk, torpedoed by a German U-boat, but he survived. But he went on to work in the OSS with Bill Donovan. On July the 30th, I'm going somewhere right now, the plane's ready to land right here, stay with me. On July the 30th, 1918, a German sniper's bullet pierced Kilmer's brain, killing him instantly. Now here's the hard part of the story, worse than him getting killed. Sadly, the fanatical Roman Catholic Kilmer, poet laureate almost for the state of New Jersey, for the Catholic Church, split hell wide open for belonging to a cult that elevated the Virgin Mary over the very one who, quote, bore his sins in his own body on the tree. It's bad enough that Kilmer's church has kept Jesus on that wooden cross through their crucifix, even though it was impossible for death to hold him, Scripture says. But the current Pope, by the way, can I tell you what's going on right now? You're not hearing a normal sermon, can you tell? You're not hearing anything he'll give you on Sunday like this, because an evangelist has that edge for God's work. I don't have to come up with four new messages every week like he does. I got about 12 sermons and a Rolex and a handkerchief. That's all we do. We're flaming evangelists. We don't have to study. And what we do is we tweak our messages. And I've got sermons I preached 40 years ago. I'm still preaching them. So we use them as greasy tools, like Jack Howell said, tools to fix things. So you never compare an outside speaker. I probably said that when I was here before. I always make that little speech. Because we have the edge. If he's bringing a special speaker and he give you something special, then you're not going to hear normally to get special results. So you don't compare us. You got that? Is there anything else, preacher? Joe, where are you at? How many of you know what the most common expression is at an Italian funeral? If he'd only kept his mouth shut. So I'm reading you a special message God gave me, that every line is important. How do you know when a lawyer is lying? When his lips are moving. You got a half spiritual evangelist. How do you know when he's speaking anything profound? Whenever he's talking. Hello? First time I preached this, the Lord asked me, where'd you get that stuff? Bad enough that Kilmer's church has kept Jesus on the cross through their crucifix. But the current Pope made news last June, this year, adding insult to injury. What do you mean? In 1987, listen to this story now. In 1987, the American artist and photographer and atheist, Andres Serrano, released his controversial photograph entitled Piss Christ. That was the title of his picture. Some of you old timers will remember the big controversy was stirred up. Why'd they call it that? The picture, black and white picture, depicted a small plastic crucifix submerged in a glass tank of the artist's own urine. During a celebration in the Sistine Chapel this year, back in June 23rd, commemorating the 50th anniversary of the Vatican's art collection, this pervert, Serrano, was not only present, having received a formal invitation to attend from the Vatican, but he also received a thumbs up by Pope Francis when he saw him, as well as a, quote, distinct, mischievous smile, end of quote. The Catholic Kilmer was right when he wrote, poems were made by fools like me. The fool hath said in his heart, there is no God. Turn to Jeremiah chapter 10, let me show you something. Rome has always hated God's trees, especially the one that Jesus died on. Hang in there. I'm so going somewhere. You know, I was saying that for about a year. I thought I heard some teenagers talking that way, so I started as a joke. I said, I so want you to get this message. I'm so going somewhere. You know, I kept saying that. One of my granddaughters heard me. She said, Dad, what are you, crazy? Pops, she called me. Teenagers stopped talking like that 10 years ago. Thanks for telling me, amen. Jeremiah chapter 10. Rome has always hated God's trees. Now, if you want to fight Christmas trees, this is the chapter you go to, okay? But let me tell you something, neighbor. I'm going to testify. You can have Santa Claus. I'll give you that bum. You can have the Easter Bunny. You can have that bum. I don't even have any patience for Halloween anymore. When I pastored 30 years ago in Idaho, I didn't have a problem with youth activities. I don't want anything to do with Halloween anymore. But Hades is going to freeze over before I give you my bale bush. I'm an ex-Catholic, man. I ain't giving up my stinking Christmas tree, you sour pussy, man. I'm telling you, neighbor, you ought to think about this stuff. That Christmas tree brings a lot of pleasure to a whole world that are normally depressed people, angry people. Everybody lights up at that time of the year. Didn't you ever notice that? Boy, I feel the love in here. Something's not right. Preacher, do you hate, you preach against Christmas trees?
No.
I can feel it. I feel the love. Can I tell you a couple of things, neighbor? That Christmas tree can't bless anybody until it dies. Anybody have a live Christmas tree with a tree? I mean, one coming out of the ground?
No.
It has to be cut down in order to bring any joy to them. And it's not the Christmas tree that brings the blessings to people. It's the beautiful ornaments hanging on the tree. Anybody alive, honey?
Yeah.
Ain't that something? And listen, neighbor, I think Jesus was just about 2 minutes old before he was laid on a piece of wood. Hey, you, how many Italians in here beside him? Okay, mangia. Mangia la guis. You ever hear that? Eat up, have a good meal. You know where that word mangia comes from? It comes from manger. You know that one. That's where the animals ate. That's where they put Jesus' body. He's just born. Then he spent his whole adult life, no teenage years in the Jewish world, right? Bar mitzvah, you become an adult at 13. He spent his whole adult life working with wood. And then I believe he died on a piece of wood, didn't he?
Yep.
Cursed is he that hangs on a tree. So if you want to fight Christmas trees, here's where you go. Look, I'm talking about Rome hates God's trees. I want to show you something. So look it over here. Verse 2, thus saith the Lord, learn not the way of the heathen. And verse 3, for their customs of the people are vain, for one cutteth a tree out of the forest, the work of the hands of the workmen with the axe. Deck the halls with boughs of holly. They deck it, hello, with silver and with gold. They fasten it with what? Nails and with what? I guess they had that at the crucifixion, didn't they? But here's the verse I want you to see. Verse 5. They are upright as the what? Palm tree. But speak not. Now, I'm going somewhere with this. If we won't turn to it for time, if you'll trust me. If you go back to the book of Judges and you read about Deborah, she's sitting under a palm tree, it says. Okay? And here, it's palm tree again. Stay with me. In both places, Judges and Jeremiah, the same Hebrew word is in the original manuscript in the Old Testament from the Jews, written in Hebrew. You all know that. The Hebrew word in Judges is the same Hebrew word in Jeremiah, and it's the word for palm tree. Now, if you go to the Roman Catholic Douay-Rheims version of the English Bible, you go to Judges and look up the verse there, you know what it says? It says palm tree. Just like the King James Bible says palm tree in the verse, because that's what the Hebrew word is. Watch it. Move over here to the book of Jeremiah. Look, same Hebrew word. So how does the King James Bible translate it? Palm tree. He's looking right at it in verse 5. You know what the Catholic Bible does in verse 5 of Jeremiah chapter 10 here? They don't have palm tree. It says they are upright like a scarecrow in a melon patch. End of quote. You go to the NIV, scarecrow in a melon patch. ESV, scarecrow in a melon patch. How the snot do you get that when it's the same word in Judges as it is in Jeremiah? How do they convert palm tree into a scarecrow in a melon patch? Rome's always hated God's trees. You know, the NIV came in, which stands for non-inspired version, it came out in 1984. In 2011, on the very year of the 400th anniversary of the King James Bible, they're throwing, you know, monkey wrenches at everything. The new NIV came out. They updated their so-called Bible, right? In 2011, to distract away from the King James Bible's 400th anniversary. I saw the front page headline of the USA Today newspaper where they had a big story about the new NIV coming out. And they quoted one of the editors of that crazy perversion, right? His quote is on the headline of USA Today. You know what it said? This time we're going to get it right. That's the crowd that makes fun of you for believing in your Bible tonight. Anybody home? Say, how'd they fix that verse? Did they go back to palm tree? No, they went from like a scarecrow in a melon patch to like a cucumber in a melon patch. Oh, pardon me, like a scarecrow in a melon patch, 1984, 2011 like a scarecrow in a cucumber patch. That's how they fixed it.
Wow.
All right. Talking about trees now. Are you still with me, neighbor? So let me pivot now because I'm going somewhere. I am so going somewhere. By the way, my snotty little granddaughter just got engaged, that same girl that last week. So, my born-again, independent Baptist friend, what about you? Have you been delivered from the burning hell where poor Joyce Kilmer and his family presently reside? I mean, the man who wrote that beautiful poem is burning with Hitler right now, if that Bible's true. I believe it could be true. Don't you believe the Bible could be true? How much do you appreciate that one described in Galatians 3:13? Cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. I don't think this hymn is in your hymn book, probably. I just wrote this down the other day. Yeah, it's not in here. You know what's a beautiful hymn? You ever heard that hymn? He did it all for me.
Yeah.
Dying upon a cruel tree is the first line of the hymn. I was preaching up in New York the other day. Turn to Hebrews 12, would you? I was preaching in, where was I at? Port Lyde, New York. And I was near Port Lyde, New York on a Thursday night. Preaching at a very sad church. The year before that, this is last June. June before that, I preached for a good man there. And 3 weeks after I preached for him, he drowned trying to save his daughter in a lake. Albert Adamkowski, very wonderful man. Wonderful man. And saved his daughter's life, but he died. And so I was back at that same church now, and his cousin is trying to hold the church together to have a preacher coming in, pulpit supply. When I met that young man, a cousin of this poor preacher that died, he's a real friendly guy. I found out he wasn't married, like 33 years old, 34 years old. But he had a girl, he really, you know, as a child, they were childhood sweethearts. But he's slow moving, 13 years old. I said, man, I know, and the girl he's talking about is a preacher's daughter. This is on Thursday night, I'm holding a service. The following Sunday in Port Lyden, I'm preaching for that girl's dad that he's interested in. I said, man, you got to get with the stinking program. How you doing? So he tells me this big, sad story, right? You know what he said? Brother Green, when I was just about 7 or 8 or 9 years old or something like that, I climbed up this real tall tree, man. And when I got up there, I took my knife out and I carved her name and my name, like I think like in a little heart. Childhood sweetheart, I'm gonna marry that girl someday. But the dude never did anything about it. So I'm, you know, trying to light a little fire under it. The following Sunday, I'm meeting the preacher in his home, and the girl's sitting there, and I said, I put some good words in for you with, what's his name over there? Blah, blah, blah. Oh, really? She's all excited. Bottom line, that dude jumped and asked her out for a date there. Now they're getting with the program. This is my cousin Benny in preservation. Can I show you a verse that matches the story I just told you? Look at Hebrews 12. Hebrews 12. Blah, blah, blah. Blah, blah, blah. Hebrews 12. Verse 1, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Look, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, endured that tree, neighbor, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. You ever heard that song? When he was on the cross, I was on his mind. That's what this verse is telling you. He's enduring all that. He has you on his mind. He's up on that tree carving your initials and your name along with his name. We are his bride, aren't we?
Amen. Amen.
Turn to John chapter 15. I've tagged second base and I'm now racing toward third base. Home plate is when you go home and eat popcorn or get on Facebook or whatever you do. John 15. Preacher, I hope you got some stuff at the house to eat. Praise God, mind you. John 15. Remember, I'm going somewhere. I'm almost coming to the knockout punch. You don't know where we're going with this. This is preliminary. See, there's no Obamacare in a Bible-believing church. You don't get anything for free. The Bible says, buy the truth and sell it not. You got to pay for truth. 2 Timothy says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed. So you got to work to get something special from God. That's what these messages are like. And you're not going to believe what we're going to deal with tomorrow night. You're not going to believe it. By the way, take a wild guess what that young man's name was up on the top of that tree, carving his future wife's initials in the tree. Name was Joshua, which means Jesus saves. Ain't that something? Look at John 15, verse 1. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Here, the one who hung on a tree for you and me is called the true vine. I go to Richmond, Virginia, to preach for our next biker. He's got a church called the True Vine Baptist Church. That guy's wild as a cob. But notice how the Holy Spirit describes you and me. The Lord is described as the true vine. Look what the Lord calls us, verse 5. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. He's called the vine and we're called the branch. But we're not just any branches. Turn to Romans 11. I don't know how deep you folks are. I hope you're deep enough to get this blessing. You should be deep. You have a good teaching pastor. Romans chapter 11. I said we're called a branch, but we're not just any branch. We're a unique branch. You want to know what the Bible says about your life here. If you go to Romans 11, we're not going to read the first 11 verses. But if you'll read those first 11 verses, you'll see that Paul talks about how the Jews rejected Jesus. He came unto his own, but his own received him not. You ought to know that, right? Now, go to verse 17. At verse 17, he's addressing the Gentiles in the church at Rome. Now, there's three kinds of people in the world, according to 1 Corinthians 10:32. Give neither offense to the Jew, nor to the Gentile, nor the church of God. You're to rightly divide the word of truth, 2 Timothy 2:15. Any verse in that Bible, take that Bible, look, flip it like that, put your finger any place you want to put it. Whatever you stop at is being addressed to either a Jew, a Gentile, or a saved person. Any Jew that's saved, any Gentile that gets saved, becomes part of the church of God. Three divisions, right? But in Rome, it's a Gentile church, meaning it's made up of converted Gentiles. Okay, now, they might be thinking they're very special here, and Paul's going to humble them a little bit here with a very important message. Stay with me, because all this has to do with where we're going, and we're that close to where we're going, right here. Starting at verse 17, he addresses the Gentiles, that's us, as to our privileged state, privileged to be in the body of Christ. Do you know if the Jews had accepted Jesus, we wouldn't even be here. We would have never come into existence. Amen. Tribulation period would have started after Nero probably, or after whoever it was. And then the Lord would come back and set up everything and we would never have even been here. They messed up and we got in because they messed up. That's where Paul's going. Watch verse 17. And if some of the branches be broken off, that means the Jews that rejected the gospel, they go to hell. They've been going to hell for 2,000 years. And if some of the branches, not all of them, because some Jews would get saved, but not many. And if some of the branches be broken off, watch it, and thou, being a what?
Wild
olive tree, were what? Grafted in among them, the natural tree, see it? And with them partakest of the root and fatness of the olive tree. Look, boast not against the branches, but if thou boast, thou bearest not the root, but the root thee. Now look at verse 19. Thou wilt say then, the branches were what? Broken off. That's talking about the Jews that rejected the gospel. God turns away from them temporarily to go out for the Gentiles. And if thou, verse 19, thou wilt say then, the branches were broken off. Why? That I might be grafted in. Because that Jew fell, we got to get in. Well, watch it, because of unbelief, they were broken off, and thou, in other words, you Gentiles now, and thou standest by faith. But look at this warning in verse 20. You want to know what's going on in the world tonight? The whole world ready to cave in to atomic war, and the rapture's going to be around the corner, and then it's going to get really crazy for those Gentiles? Watch it. Look at the last part of verse 20. Be not what? High-minded. You're so special and so important. Be not high-minded, but what?
Fear.
Fear. Fear. Why fear? For if God spared not the natural branches, what does that mean? I don't know. Anybody ever heard of the Holocaust?
No.
2,000 years of persecution that Jews been suffering. The Roman army surrounded Jerusalem. Just like Jesus said, they're coming. When you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, head for the hills, he told his followers. 30 years after they crucified him, the Jews are under the siege of the Roman army. Look, 70 AD. They got the city cut off and I got a painting, preacher, as big as that piano on my wall of the siege of the city of Jerusalem at nighttime. It's a dramatic picture. Every night, those Jews would sneak over the wall or go under the wall trying to escape, and 90% of them were getting caught. Every day when the sunlight came up, there were 500 new or added Jews hanging on crosses in front of the North Wall. 500,000, 1,500 now, 2,000. You know what Josephus, the Jewish historian, said? They kept crucifying those Jews, ready? Until they ran out of wood and places to put the newest crosses. What is that all about? I don't know. 30 years earlier, the previous generation screaming for his blood with Pontius Pilate, his blood be upon us and our children. Well, there's the children out there on the crosses everywhere. Be careful what you say, neighbor. See, somebody said this, look. Help us, Jesus. So much for that illustration. Look, Judaism, look, is the stalk on which the rose of Christianity bloomed. We came out of the Jews' rejection of the gospel. But look at this, I'm going somewhere. Watch this. There's a lesson here for you to get under your skin if you can get it. Look. Verse 21, for if God spared not the natural branches in their unbelief, take heed lest he also spare not what?
Thee.
Behold therefore the goodness and the severity of God. On them which fell, severity. My wife was a nurse when we got married. She's into autopsy TV shows, all that blood and gore. None of that bothers her as a nurse. It took me 6 years to write that purple book back there. 18,000 hours, according to a time study. The purple book is the book on the history of modern Israel. 6 years. I got 3 chapters in there on the Holocaust. My wife's my proofreader. Preacher, it took us a year out of the 6 years to write the 3 chapters on the Holocaust. I went over there through Auschwitz, all those camps. Listen. My wife's my proofreader. That 1 year when she was working on those 3 chapters, The autopsy gal, my wife, had to walk away from that computer screen probably a dozen times, couldn't take what she's reading.
You look at some of the photographs in there, you'll see. There's a picture in there of four Jewish women ready to be executed. They're in their undergarments to mock them. Famous photograph, look at it, back in the book. And I've looked at that for years. I said, honey, look at those four precious women there. My wife said, she looked at it, proofread it. She said, there's not four women in that picture, there's five. I've been looking at that picture forever. Four women, look. But over here is a little 9-year-old girl with her head laying on the hip. And the woman there just scared to death. She's going down there.
Behold, therefore, verse 22, the goodness and severity of God on them which fell severity, but toward thee, in other words, you Gentiles in Rome that are getting into the church now, but toward thee, what? Goodness, right?
Yep.
What's the next word?
Amen.
What's the next word? If thou continue in his goodness, otherwise thou shalt also be cut off. Now let me ask you a question. You see what he did to the natural branches? What do you think he's going to do to the wild branches? Not nearly as important on paper.
Yeah.
You wild ones are coming. Look what he did to his own children.
Amen.
For rejecting Jesus.
Amen.
This Gentile world we're living in now hates God like nobody's business.
Yeah.
Brown University in Providence, Rhode Island, the oldest Baptist college in this country. Ivy League school started in the 1600s, Brown, by Baptist people. The other day, preacher, and there's no Christians in there now, but to show you how perverted the legacies go, the other day they had a statistic that came out, 40% of the current student body at Brown University identifies as LGBTQ. 4 out of every 10 young people. I don't know what I am. The number one Christian song 2 months ago on the internet. Christian single put out by an LGBTQ pervert named Flamey Grant. You heard of Amy Grant? He calls himself Flamey Grant. Number one. Number one. Aren't you glad that Ashbury Revival in Kentucky changed America for good? But that Jew is coming back. Verse 23, and they also, if they abide not still in unbelief, shall be grafted in. For God is able to graft them in again. Aren't you glad to hear that? That Jew's going to get right.
Yeah.
Now, with all that in mind, I don't know if you keep track of what's going on in the world, some of you. But last May this year, May the 15th, Israel had its 75th anniversary of its statehood. This thing we're in now is about over. I tell churches, don't buy any cemetery plots on cash. Buy them on time payments. We're getting ready to get out of here. But let me tell you something scary here because of everything I just shared with you. I believe that every saved Gentile will have to answer to every Jew burning in hell for what he or she did for Jesus, because that Jew fell, we got in. And you're going to have to give an account to them for what you've done with your Christian life. In a principle. Look, you don't have to be any more spiritual than to have seen Saving Private Ryan. My wife's daddy landed on Omaha Beach, second wave, June 6th. What's that closing scene? I'm not trying to glorify Hollywood here, but popular film, fairly clean on paper, as still films go, but most all of you are familiar with it. And there's the dude dying, look. And he gets Ryan to come up to him and he whispers in his ear. Remember what he whispers? Earn this. I gave my life to find you and rescue you. Now I'm dying. Earn it. What are you doing?
Amen.
You got in because that Jew went to hell? Is your life reflecting gratitude? Okay. All of that was introduction to get to the main thought. Here's the main thought. God gave it to me. It blessed me. Every time, recently, about 6 months ago, God gave this to me. And everywhere I've preached it, God has used it in a good way. So get ready for God to hammer on you. Ready? Hey, you know, we're Yankees, okay? You know what the difference between a Southerner and a Yankee? Don't tell my wife I said this. She's from Virginia, amen? A Southerner can be patting you on the back while he's planning your funeral. Bless your heart. Am I right? That's the truth. They don't call the Deep South for nothing. Say amen on that one.
Amen.
Well, what about a Yankee? Well, a Yankee can walk into a cancer ward and say, "What's eating you, bub?" You know, they're exact opposites. Jack Howes used to say he never saw a theologian who could preach or an evangelist who could read and write. So I'm a Yankee, so I'm coming right in the front door with you other Yankees. God's coming after you right now. Ready? I'm telling you, you think I'm making a big speech for nothing? The main thought of this message revolves around a practical application to an important spiritual question. Stay with me. So what's the question? You know, left, right? This is the left, but the right I'm going to give you in a minute is going to knock you out. But this is setting you up. Ready? Is it okay if I ask you a question? What have you done lately for the one who hung on a tree for thee? What have you done lately for the one who hung on a tree for you? The foundation text from the thought that I'm going to give you now in about 65 seconds, the foundation Bible verse for this thought is Hebrews 11:6. But without faith, it is impossible to please God. We're all familiar with that. So here comes the knockout. Ready? Now look, let's make a deal. If you just sit out there and look at me like a deer with a headlight look, I'm an old man. I'm 70 years old. I got a million stories. We can stay here till midnight. All you got to do is act interested in when you hear this. And then we'll keep moving. You just give me one of these things, oh, we'll be here forever. And I make up stuff. I don't just. I'm serious. I do. God knows I do. All evangelists do that. Then he called Bob Gray. What them dudes? I don't do a lot of stuff, but most of them do a lot. Hey, you got a dead meeting? You got a dead invitation, right? Everybody's looking up. You're looking for something, you know, raise your hand or something, and nobody's got their hand up. All you got to do is look around and look at a guy's hand. I see that hand. No, nobody knows what you're looking at. No, I wouldn't do that. Praise God. Hey, sit down back there, please. Sit down. Nobody's doing that. Praise God. We learned that from Jack Howes in the balcony. Sit down. Ain't nobody standing there. They asked Charles Spurgeon, what should you do when people fall asleep in church? He said, somebody should wake up to preach. Okay, with all that build-up, fun, humor, now here comes the moment of truth. And I'm just kidding with you. You won't have to act impressed or surprised or awestruck. You will be, right? Ready? My whole sermon, everything tonight, revolves around this one statement I'm going to make. Ready? If my Lord could hang on a tree for me, surely I can go out on a limb for him. Amen. You're called a branch, aren't you? The one who hung on your on a tree for you is called a vine. Did he hang on a tree for you?
Amen.
Well, can't you go out on a limb for him? Without faith, it is impossible to please God. How much have you done for the Lord lately? The famous British missionary C.T. Studd put it this way, if Jesus Christ be God and died for me, then no sacrifice can be too great for me to make for him. The same missionary also said, only one life will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. I had a very spooky experience. I spent 9 months trying to get an interview with Madame Chiang Kai-shek. She was the first lady of China during World War II. She lived to be 105 years old. I spent 9 months trying to get an interview with her. Her husband was Chiang Kai-shek, the generalissimo, chased out of mainland China by Mao Zedong, chased down to Taiwan. After 9 months, I was given permission to come to her Manhattan apartment, photograph her furniture, which was a way to get to interview her. I made a $3,000 documentary on her life, pictures with Bob Jones Sr. giving an honorary doctor's degree to her husband. They were both Christian people. George Beverly Shea flew all the way to China just to sing "How Great Thou Art" in her presence. But the day I got there, she died. 105, she can't live one more day. I mean, I didn't get to see her. She died, I got to the apartment where she was supposed to go to carry her body out 3 hours earlier. You couldn't make up stuff like that. I was invited to go to the funeral, though, by the ambassador, Mr. Ambassador Andrew. But long story short, I was invited to sign her guest book at the embassy in Manhattan. And I was the only English letters in there that I could see. And I said it was a great honor researching and writing about the life of Madam Chiang Kai-shek. Only one life. Will soon be passed, only what's done for Christ will last. C.T. Studd, the missionary, proved his convictions by spending the last 10 years of his life in darkest Africa. What's his third quote? Everybody's used to hearing. Some wish to live within the sound of church or chapel bell. I want to run a rescue shop within a yard of hell. Traveled around with a converted headhunter, a cannibal, in case there were problems in the services, right? C.T. Studd would be preaching, a bunch of wild Africans start trouble. That cannibal would jump up, tear his shirt off. Remember this in his biography, wander around and say, "Sit down, shut up. I've eaten better men than you." That's a direct quote. Some wish to live within the sound of church or chapel bell. Look here. See the tree, Brent? See the trunk of the tree? Some wish to live within the sound of church or chapel bell. I want to run a rescue shop within a yard of hell. COVID.
Yeah.
Look at your life right now. Can you look at your life? Where are you? Are you hugging that trunk? Or are you going out on that branch? Or on that limb? If he could die, if he could hang on a tree for me, surely I can go out on a limb for him. Why? Without faith, it takes faith to go out on a limb. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. The Oxford Dictionary describes the metaphorical phrase "going out on a limb" as follows, quote, "going into a dangerous or uncompromising position where one is not joined or supported by anyone else." Vulnerable. I'm sure you know how to pay for this roof, right, preacher?
No.
You don't? You mean you're not quitting the church and escaping to go someplace else? You're going to stick it out here and fight it out with your people? Hey, Tano! We're surrounded by Indians. What you mean, we, white man? Remember that old joke? I ain't gonna stick by. The obvious sense of that definition by Oxford is that the further out you go on a limb, further you go, the greater the chance that the branch might snap, throwing you to the ground. Philadelphia church, by the way, you wouldn't have a country if George Washington didn't believe what I'm telling you. And he was a saved man, baptized by John Gano, his number one chaplain, pastor of the First Baptist Church of New York City. You know, we hadn't won a battle when the war started, 1776. Enlistments are going to be up December the 31st, and nobody was going to re-enlist. The war was over. The American soldiers hadn't won a battle, and they hadn't gone on the offensive yet. They're running from every encounter with the British, losing everything. You know what George Washington said? He gave his Donald Trump impersonation. Christmas night, he said, "What the blank do we got to lose?" So what did he do? He crossed the Delaware River in a storm.
Christmas night when everybody's depressed in America. Christmas is such a blessing everybody looks forward to. But what about 5 o'clock, even though it's in the evening, it starts getting the... It's universal depression sets in. There are more suicides on Christmas night than almost any night of the year. Oh, listen, man, I don't know what I'm talking about. You know what, George, if you get depressed on Christmas night, just remind yourself, that's when America was born. Because he crossed the Delaware River and come up the shoreline and surprised the German troops there at Trenton. They were all drunk. One loyalist doctor, meaning loyalist meaning an American who was not for the revolution, he saw Washington's men coming. He runs up to the Trenton garrison where the Germans were. The commandant's name was Rob. And he demands at the front door, I've got to see Colonel Rob. Blah, blah. He can't be disturbed. He's playing cards. Well, at least give him this note. He writes a whole note out. Washington, you want to know where your country came from? I don't know if God ever intervened in things. He probably, Bible could be true, don't get mad at me. I've said that already tonight. He scrambles a note. Washington's coming, give this to the commandant. The guy walks in, hands it to the general, or the colonel, Rao. He's playing cards. He takes that, he's half drunk, takes that note, sticks it in his pocket. 3 hours later, Washington's men blow into the joint. They capture 700 Germans, kill 22 of them, and don't lose a man. First time America won anything in a war. Here's General Rahl laying on a table, like bleeding like a pig. He asked to see Washington so he could surrender his sword, asked him to look after his men. You know what he said? He pulled that nasty, bloody note out of his pocket, said, if I would have read this last night, I would not be here today. And then he kicked them up. And enlistments went through the roof. Hey, we want some. That's where your country came from. Somebody went out of the loop for you. Man.
Philadelphia Church Age missionaries, starting in the 1790s, 1800s, they were famous for two things. You want to know what old school missionaries were like before the modern day? Two things they were famous for. Number one, one-way tickets on steamers. No round trips, one-ways. And let me tell you about their luggage. They all carried about one bag with them. It was casket. Took coffins overseas with them. Stuffed all their earthly possessions in a casket. The casket that they would die in and be buried in. Just preached out in Branson, Missouri, Labor Day weekend. I go to the same church 5 times a year. Jim Baker Theater is 2 miles from the church. Jim Baker's current wife is such a whack job, Lori Baker. She'd make Tammy Baker look like Beverly Hiles. Somebody say amen right there. Her famous testimony is she had 5 abortions. Can I tell you about another expecting mother on a mission field? Her name was Pamela. She was told by the doctors, if you don't get an abortion, you're going to die probably. You know what she said? I'll just trust God, that's all. And I'll go out on a limb. She didn't get the abortion. Her son, Timmy Tebow, was pretty happy about that. So, what about you and this holy theme? Let me repeat for clarity's sake. If he could hang on a tree for me, I can go out on a limb for him. Not hard to understand. By the way, newsflash, duh. Mic drop moment, listen. It would help us if we could even understand what the basic concept means. Maybe you don't get it. This is simply boils down to living a life of faith, like Lester Olof used to talk about. Dr. Jack Howes used to say, stick your neck out. Take a chance. Football, it's called a Hail Mary pass, isn't it? Yeah. Basketball and hockey, what's it called? Shoot your shot. Yep. Boxing, look, if you're not any more spiritual than Rocky Balboa fan, what'd he say? Go for it. Some of those heathens got more guts than the Christians. D.L. Moody was in England as a young evangelist, doing everything in the flesh, no real spiritual success yet. And it's a famous story. He heard a preacher make a statement, Henry Varley, and the statement turned Moody's life upside down. Look, the statement was, the world has yet to see what God can do with a man fully yielded to his will. Moody's sitting there saying in his heart, by the grace of God, I'll be that man. He was challenged by that statement. Somebody here could be challenged tonight. By the way, look here. You could take your phone sometime and do this. Look, you can't make this stuff up. I got my phone turned off here, so I don't freak anybody out. But if you take your phone, I was saved 30 years before I learned this. Want to see something freak you out? D.L. Moody, Beatitudes. Yeah, here you go, neighbor. You put that on your phone, you won't be able to hear this. D.L. Moody is on a record. You know, Satan's nickname is the Prince of the Power of the Air. How many problems you ever have in a church with your microphones? That's D.L. Moody reading the Beatitudes, 1897. Hunger and thirst after righteousness. You can hear it if you're up close. A little hard to read it all through this mic here, but if you put it on your phone, you can hear every word he's saying. He preached to 100 million people without a microphone. Bible could be true, you never know. Hey, young preacher boys, young men here, with people with spiritual aspirations, whoever you might be out there, if you aim at nothing, you'll hit it every time. D.L. Moody said, if God is your co-pilot, make your plans big. Want a scripture to go with that? Psalm 81:10, open thy mouth wide, and I'll fill it. God wants to do something with your life, person, young person, but you got to let him do it. You got to be willing to get away from that trunk and go on out on that branch. Don't be guilty of what the Jews did to Jehovah, the God of Israel. Psalm 78:41 says, how often did they provoke him in the wilderness and grieve him in the desert? Yea, they turned back and tempted God. Listen to this. And limited the Holy One of Israel. You can limit God just by an indifferent lifestyle. All this time, God wants something from your life. You were created for a reason, and God's waiting for you to get with the program. But this is your God. Now, I'm not trying to be ugly, but this is the problem in 90% of the churches I go in. Yeah. You know what mission? You know what the Baptist missionary William Carey said? He went to India for 45 years, never came back once. Attempt great things for God, expect great things from God. And who hasn't been challenged by the legacy of the great missionary martyr, Jim Elliot, who said, that man is no fool who gives up what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose. Now listen to this. I've tagged third base several minutes ago. I'm racing toward home plate now. Home plate is where the popcorn is. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Oddly enough, the greatest quote that summarizes the all-important incentive for going out on a limb for God was made by an unsaved man, a guy named Frank Scully. Mark Twain is what most of the quotes will tell you, but it's not Mark Twain, it was Frank Scully. That doesn't matter, but listen to what an unsaved man said. In other words, he's the one who'll tell you why you should go out on them. A lost man can tell you why. Here's this quote, ready? Quote, why not go out on a limb? Isn't that where the fruit is? Duh. I am the vine. Ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me you can do nothing. Fruit's out on the branch, not by the trunk. Are you living a life of faith for him? Let me ask you a question now. When was the last time you took a leap of faith? Now let me close this message with a word of testimony and we'll be out of here, okay? 49 years ago, last month, August the 18th, my wife and I checked into the Maui Surf Hotel. We just got married August 17th, 1974, went straight to Maui. What a terrible thing has happened there. I was saved on August the 25th, 1974, the very day we came, the day after we came home from Hawaii. For half of a century now, I've been trying to go out on a limb for him. I practice what I'm preaching, 1,000 miles a week, no complaints, 70 years old, doing fine. As long as I got a thermos, amen, and a pastor that'll cook breakfast for me, I don't want no nasty spinach, excuse me. Two years after I got saved, God had called me to preach, and then we went to Hiles Anderson College. We left the swankiest apartment in the history of apartments. Hello, you know what today is? This is 2023. Can I go back 50 years? 1974, I came back from Hawaii. I mean, the captain got on the intercom, Mr. and Mrs. Grady on board. I'm sitting in first class in United Airlines. I work for an airline, didn't pay for my ticket. Everybody on the plane claps for my wife and I. He sends us a bottle of champagne from the cockpit. I was there when it happened, amen? True story, I do make up some things. That's 100% true. Got back from Hawaii, a week in Hawaii. Look, on a Saturday, I carried my wife across the threshold of our brand new apartment in Philadelphia. An hour later, the doorbells start ringing. My perverted friends are coming over with Johnny Walker, J&B Scotch. We're gonna party. Welcome Bill home. My wife's real excited about that. Hello, first night in our honeymoon suite, our home. And anyway, I'm just telling you this for a reason. I turned my television on before I buzz them in. I don't know, they're buzzing from the lobby. I'm on the third floor. Turn my television set on channel 2. Check them out on the screen. Oh, that's crazy, my best man. Okay, come on in, Mike, buzz them in. Did you hear what I just said? 1974 security cameras hooked up in our lobby connected to my television. Let me know when you run into that even here today. That's 50 years ago. We were making big bucks. She was a nurse, and I was working for the largest airline in the world. Hey, that's how we started out, but guess what? I got saved the next morning, Sunday morning, in October, I got called to preach. And all of a sudden, my wife is a nurse. She's gonna be a preacher's wife now. Hey, I didn't sign up for this. But she never said that. You know what happened? 2 years later, after I got saved, time to leave and go out to Hiles Anderson College. Hello, neighbor. You know what we did? We checked into the Meadows Apartments because all the college students went there. I didn't even have a job. No job, preacher. I quit my career. I'm a dummy. Hello. I'm an idiot savant. I can do one thing right. I can write, but I have no technical skills. I can't even. Somebody said, what kind of a phone do I have? I don't know what that is. I've been using it for 3 years. I don't even know if that's an iPhone or a Z phone. I don't even know what that is. I'm not insecure. I got to have it in Indiana to go to Hiles Anderson College. I didn't have a job. My wife's 8 months pregnant with our son that just went there. Look here, neighbor. How'd you go out like that? In faith! Went out of the limb. I didn't know where God was going to take care of me, but I believe he was up there. You know what happened? I got a lead from the college. Hey, there's a factory that builds army tanks, Blount Ox Foundry. They're hiring, but you got to be able to read a micrometer. You think I knew what a micrometer was? I started pronouncing a micrometer right away. Micrometer. That's what I thought of. And in my brain, I just kept thinking it's like a periscope in a submarine. I got to be able to read it. I never even saw a micrometer. So I didn't know what to do. I just signed up for the interview. 5 minutes before I'm going into the interview, guy coming out saying, Bill, you know how to use a micrometer, they're gonna test you here. I said, I ain't never even seen a micrometer. He pulled one out of his pocket. Here, what the heck is that? I gotta pass the test in there. You think I can pass the test? He gives me a crash course, look at him lying. I could have taken 6 months to study that and couldn't pass. That's just me, okay? Look, learn to laugh at yourself. If you don't, somebody else will take the job. I go in there scared to death. I sit down in front of this guy at the desk. And I pull out the application, hands me the micrometer. He starts giving me instructions. Brother,
I didn't flunk. I got a zero. I didn't get anything. I got a wife and old pregnant wife of my college career. Doing a job at that. We weren't hired like all over America back then like that. You know what? If you step out in faith, God will take care of you just about all the time.
Yeah.
When I was all done flunking my test, I watched that man take his pen picture, and on the top of the paper, he wrote three letters, B-A-C, put a circle on it. I got hired next week. I didn't know B-A-C stood for Born Again Christian. The guy interviewed me was a deacon at Dyer Baptist Church there, and about 20 minutes away from the house, and this guy. How many of you think the Bible could be true? Give me something. Don't you think it could be true? Went to college for 5 years, living in a nasty apartment called the Meadows. Like 5 years later, it had a nickname, the Ghettos. God called me to start a church in Idaho. The last day I'm in my apartment. 5 years. Remember my wife at the fancy apartment with the TV screens? We didn't have no TV screens. Had a lot of cockroaches. I'm sitting in the kitchen of the Meadows, preacher. My wife's dad and brother are going down the hallway carrying our furniture. I'm sitting there the last day of 5 years living in that place. Finished college now. I'm feeding the roaches with crackers. Hey, boys, the board is yours. Now have fun. If I'm alive, the Lord's going to be dead if I just been dead. That's what my wife endures. And off we go to Idaho. Get out there for five, build a church out there. First week we got there, I didn't have any job again. We had 14 people wanted to start a church in the living room. I needed $258 a week for a suicide budget where I wouldn't work a secular job, and I was willing to do it. Passed the hat, look at me, passed the hat. We needed $257. Came in the hat. I never worked a day in 5 years. Built a new church, 20 acres of ground, built a 6,000 square foot building. God was awfully good to us, but why? Because I had stepped out of faith. Oh, by the way, I didn't tell you this. The last day I was in Indiana, feeding the roaches, remember? I went to hear Johnny Pope preach at Lowell Baptist Church. I wanted some last windup to get me psyched up to go out there. I'm going to Idaho. I never even heard of Idaho. I've preached at every state in this country now, but I'm a dweeb back then. Never been to Idaho. I got mixed up with Iowa, for real. I went to hear Johnny Pope preach. I just got ordained. I got an ordination Bible with me. This is like Friday before we're going to leave, maybe Sunday or Monday or something. Look, last day or two in the town, I'm sitting there with my ordination Bible. Johnny Pope's going to preach. And a lady stands up to sing a special. I want to get that out of the way. I want to hear what he's going to preach. Brother, she sang a song that blew me into next week. Little as much. And God is in it.
Yeah.
And boy, God got on top of it. And she got to the line, does the place you called the service seem so small and little known? Yeah. It is greater. God is in it. And he'll not forget his own. I'm like this. After she finished, Johnny Pope got up to preach. I grabbed the hymn book, found the hymn, got my ordination Bible, and I'm copying every word of every stanza of that hymn into my ordination Bible. When I'm all done, Johnny Pope's back doing this sermon. I had no idea what he said. But I know what she sang, little as much if God is in it. And you know, we were out there for 5 years, starting at a new church, and then God called me back to teach at Jack House College. I came back here, you know what? I didn't know what was going to happen. First thing I found out was I had a $10,000 salary cut. 60 people I'm pastoring. To come back to teach 400 young men to preach in a college, My salary was cut by $10,000. Can I tell you the luxurious accommodations I had? An 800 square foot rented house. Three children now, a wife, a dog, and a cat. And you willing to do that stuff for the Lord? Just like you better be willing to do it, sure enough. And I'll close with this. While I was out there, the Lord taught me the King James Bible issue. Remember that? But what I, about the time the Lord showed me the King James issue for the first time, about 1988, I got into a real bad car accident. Somebody hit me from some guy from Iran, drunken Middle Eastern dude, ran into me at a Chicago intersection. The lawsuit dragged on for several years. We're living in a nasty 800 square foot rented house. My precious wife, she gave up this fancy schmancy apartment years ago, never complained. God will test you for a while, you know that? Finally, we got the lawsuit settled, and I got $100,000. This is back in 1989, 1990. Third went to the lawyer, had $60,000. Hey, that's enough money to get a house started. Hey, honey, we got it made, look. Well, we got some bills, we got a tithe. We got some more money to give to the bus ministry in Hammond. You know, it's a couple of missionaries. And when it was all over, look, it was down to $25,000. Did you know riches take, have wings, are deceitful, take wings and fly? Then a bunch of money disappears. Buy it. I'm down to 25. My wife wouldn't smile now. We had 60, now we got 25. Oh, honey, that's plenty to put a down payment on the house. I know it is. I hope it is. It'll be okay. Then I got along with the Lord about something, and he blew my mind. You know what he said to my heart? He said, did I tell you to stop giving at 25? I don't remember telling you. I said, Lord, I married them, my mommy. She wants a house. I said, hey, son, when I want you to stop giving, I'll let you know. Man, I went back into the bedroom. My wife's sitting on it. Remember the waterbed? You wake up sitting in the sitting on the edge of a whole heavy waterbed. And I told her, I've got something to tell you. She got real serious. She could tell I had a bad stuff. She got off the waterbed, sat on the floor, put her back up against the waterbed. What is it? I said, well, I was just talking to the Lord there, and he kind of said that we shouldn't cut it off at $25,000. He may want me to give more of this away to his work. She just looked at me and started crying. She didn't get mad, didn't cuss. I don't think she cussed. But she had a sad look on her face. And look, I'm 2 feet from home plate now. 2 feet from home plate. You know what I told my wife? I said, honey, let me tell you something that might help you. There's a sermon illustration I heard years earlier about an Indian, the Raji. You know what the Raji is? He's a royal person, you know, like a prince. And the Raji's coming down a trail, the street in a broken down old poverty-stricken village, being carried, you know, on the four shoulders, you know, carrying the carriage. And they go hut to hut, look. And as they stop at each hut, his tax collector or whatever would come up to the hut, and when a man would come out, he would do this, look. And he had a bag, preacher, and he put the bag out, and he said, grain for the Raji. Grain for the Raji. Whatever you want to give. No obligation. People take their grain bags, preacher, look, pour some of the grain into his big bag, and then the representative of the Raji would go. And the Raji would wave from the carriage, and they'd go down the road, two of them again, to the next village or the next hut. Well, the Raji's man came to this one hut, and the guy that was in there was bony, rags for clothes, cursing the day of his birth kind of guy. And he had to meet this guy that comes in and said, grain for the Raji. This man was so miserable, he took his bag of grain, look. And he put his hand in the bag, and he pulled out one piece of grain. Before anything, with contempt on his face, look. Dropped it into the bag. The guy said, well, thank you for whatever. And he goes on down the road, and Raji waves at that nasty old man that was so bitter. Down the road they went. About 5 or 10 minutes later, that man was so bitter. Now, Scrooges are, they're counting their money all the time. He put his hand down in the bag. He was so mad, he was one piece of grain short. This is the story I'm telling my wife when she's sitting there at the waterbed. When that man got mad, he put his hand in the bag that peeled a little bit of grain he had left, and he felt something in that bag. Like a marble. Something real hard, big, much bigger than any single piece of grain. He didn't know what it was. Preacher pulled his hand out. There was a big old diamond. Don't miss it. One diamond, one piece of grain. And within a couple of seconds, reality dawned on him. He ran out of that hut like a crazy man, and the Raji was way on down the road. He starts running, but it's too late. What's that saying we quoted tonight already? Only one life to assume you pass. Only what's done for Christ to last. You understand? One diamond for each piece of grain. If he'd just put a little more in there, he'd have got a lot more back. One grain, one diamond. I told that to my wife. I said, honey, we got to trust the Raji. I said, I'll tell you what we'll do, honey. We'll do two things. We'll give the Lord a timetable. We can't wait forever to buy a house. He's got 30 days to speak to me about giving more money away. And if he doesn't speak to us, you or me, we'll take the 25 and try to get a house. She barely accepted that with her face. But then I said, honey, and here's how we're going to do things, ready? You do what I do for the next 30 days, look. Every time I was sitting in church, man. You hear anything? I didn't hear anything. You know, the spoiler alert for the movie? You know, he that sits in the heaven shall last. 30 days went by. Nobody spoke to me about anything, except the Lord spoke to my heart to write that book back there, Final Authority. During that 30 days on the King James Bible, holy mackerel, I called R.R. Donnelly and Sons, the oldest printer in America, used to print in Chicago, found out how much it would cost to print 5,000 copies of that white book back there. You want to know how much it cost? $25,000, every penny that we had left. That book came out, my marriage is on the line. I fasted 40 days, and we released it at Dan Woodward's God Save America rally in White, Illinois, 30 years ago this past March. And guess what? The whole 5,000 books were sold in probably 3 weeks. We got another 5,000, they went out. Got another 5,000, they went out. Watch, neighbor. I'm 1 foot from home plate, 6 inches right here above. You know what happened? By the fall, we had enough money just from those books selling like crazy to be able to buy our first home. We bought a house right across the street from Hiles Anderson College. 3,000 square feet, upstairs, downstairs, basement. Had a bar in the basement. That was Grady's Pub. Grady's publication was on the first floor. Grady's Pub was, I didn't use it much. Richard, we moved in the 1st of November, 2nd week of November, maybe. Look, a week after we moved in, maybe 2 weeks at the most, we're sitting in this beautiful home. I walked to Hiles Anderson College to go to work. It was just in the most trees, deer. And guess what? You know what I told my wife? I said, honey, you know why we're in here? We're sitting on the couch looking through the bay window, holding hands. I said, honey, let me tell you the only reason we're in here tonight is because we trusted the Raji. We offered him the whole bag of what we had if he wanted. Now we're diverting it to his workbook. And I said, the Raji didn't do us bad. Took care of us. And here's the end of the story, the part that if you told this to me, I wouldn't believe it. A week after we moved in, preacher, it was Thanksgiving. And I love Thanksgiving. I was born on Thanksgiving. Make a note. November 27th. We went to church Thursday morning, Thanksgiving service. Jack Howell's preaching a sermon. We're sitting there. We just moved into our new house 2 weeks ago. Jack Howell has a Thanksgiving sermon. You know what? Every sermon has a closing illustration on there, right? The end? Something to keep your attention. Summarize everything. We're sitting there enjoying ourselves. Can't wait to go home and eat some turkey. Jack Howell's sermon ends with a closing illustration. You know how cool God is. I hope you know how cool he is. You don't know you're missing something. You know what Jack Howell's closing illustration was? Look. Rain for the rising. Rain for the rising. We just looked at each other in shock. I'm done. I'm all done. If he could hang on a tree for you, you'd go out on a limb for him, wouldn't you? Are you? Let's bow our heads for prayer. Heads bowed and eyes closed.
Pastor, I'm going to turn this over to you in just 30 seconds or less. Very attentive audience, very just making it easy to preach. I sure appreciate that. But nobody's looking around. You're a sensitive congregation. I've been here twice or three times before. I know what you're like. You're all good folks. But I wonder if the Lord spoke to anybody tonight about some matter of faith. If you do this, this is the big gamble. If you do this, there's a chance something might go wrong. And safer to hang around the trunk of that tree. Can you let the Lord talk to you if he wants to talk to you? And God's saying, why don't you come out here a little bit? Yeah, but I might fall off, the branch might break. And the Lord says, that's the idea. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. You can't go out on that branch without exercising faith. Is God speaking to your heart about any application tonight? Who would say, preacher, not I enjoyed the sermon, most all of you did. I've been looking at your faces. You're smiling, happy, engaged, I know that. But you say, preacher, it's more than just enjoy the sermon. God get into my little heart and spoke to me about some matter of faith that I'm not really caring for at the moment, but I'm being challenged by the Holy Spirit as we're seated here to go out on that limb a little bit. And I want the Lord to know about it tonight before I go home. I'm grateful that he spoke to me, but I'd like to follow through on it if he's speaking to me. Nobody's looking around. Who'd say, preacher? That's me tonight. Would you lift your hand nice and high? Nobody looking. Good night, preacher. Hands all over the room. Hands all over the room. Thank you. You may lower your hands. You're a sensitive group. And I love you folks. I loved your pastor. He used to be one of my students. Prayed for Nate all over the place when he was sick. I love being here. Would somebody say, preacher, God, I didn't raise my hand just now because God spoke to me about a different application, something else. Nothing to do with the whole idea of faith even. But something you said tonight triggered a sidetrack. God took me somewhere else tonight. Nobody in the grandmother could know what it was tonight, but I know what it is. I didn't raise my hand with these others. I'd kind of like to care for this tonight in this particular area. Nobody knows but me and God. Would you lift your hand if God spoke to you about that? God bless you, ma'am, and God bless you in the back. Praise the Lord. Anybody say, preacher, I'm not even sure that I'm saved tonight. If I died, I don't know that I'd go to heaven. Would you pray for me, Brother Grady? Anybody like that? Raise your hand if you're not sure you're saved. Yeah, I see that hand, sir. Anybody else? Well, would you wait just a moment? Heads bowed and eyes closed. Why don't we stand to our feet? Nobody looking. I'm going to have a little prayer. I understand you don't have a piano player here. I don't know what you do for an invitation. Pastor, why don't you come? Take charge. Hands went up all over the place. And there was one young man in the back there raised the hand for salvation. You probably know who's who here on the aisle with the purple shirt. I'll turn it over to you, preacher.
Oh, it's so comfortable. In a scary situation to hang out to the tree. No great work is done when we cling to the tree.
Yeah.
If God is speaking to your heart, whatever it is, if you aren't sure about your salvation, I'll meet you right up front. If God is speaking to you, as fellas, why don't you play some? Our heads are bowed. Why don't we come? If God is working on you, just find a place at this altar. As some music plays. You got something, Nate? Got something? Why don't you come? Step out of your seat. Step out. Step out on the limb. to Jesus. What are you holding back? What are you clinging to? Surrender all to Jesus. I surrender. I remember when I got right with the Lord, Jack Hiles preached. 1979 or 1989, getting right with God. I remember hearing this song play, 20 verses of it. I'm clinging to the seat in front of me. I knew the difference between light and darkness. I knew the world is darkness. And I find today, as here we are doing our best to walk with God and honor Him, I find myself starting to cling to things. I find myself grabbing hold of things in this day of a troubled world, right?
Right.
How are we going to make ends meet?
Yeah.
How am I going to take care of my family? Financial concerns. Oh, just the more we ought to. We're going to need Him. We're going to need Him. Today I looked. Have a seat, folks. Have a seat. Tracy, I think, is settling his salvation. You can turn that off, guys. Today I looked on the face of a dead body.
Yeah.
I looked at Betty Moon's face. Pastored her for 24 years. I saw her. No more problems. No more concerns. Her body racked with arthritis. Her hands couldn't even open. Her feet curled over. I watched her for several days. Her heart stopped. I said, when did it happen, Dev? He said, between 7 and 8 this morning, I heard a stop. 50 years they've been married. 75 years old, that little heart. For 75 years. One day ours will stop.
That's right.
And all that really matters is truly getting out on that limb. That's all that really matters. As Brother Grady said, what have you done for the Lord lately? You. That's, in this dark day, I'll tell you, that little light can sure shine in some darkness. Let's let it shine. As Brother Grady said, you know, the Bible could be true. I think it is true. I think today we need to believe it more than ever,
amen.
Follow it more than ever,
amen.
Share it more than ever. Let's grab hold of it. Amen. Let's, Tracy is settling his salvation. We'll let you know. Fellas, why don't you come on down? This will be for Brother Grady. And I have to admit, I started, read Final Authority, some of the other books, your latest one. What's the name of it?
Perilous
Times. I started it, and I promise, Brother Grady, I'm going to finish it. Amen. Let's pray. Thank you for being here, folks. Tomorrow night, bring a friend. I think Brother Grady's the kind of person someone can listen to that maybe wouldn't want to come to church. Invite someone, a friend, a neighbor, a family member, and we'll have a good time tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. Thank you, Brother Grady. I've been blessed. When I saw you folks come in tonight, I've been encouraged. Amen. Pray for the busy week. Pray for the families, funerals. Never thought we'd be opening a funeral chapel, three this week. Troubled times. So pray for Nevin. I'm sure he'll be at home. Hey, if you're driving by, stop by and see Nevin. Bring him maybe a meal. That, you understand, his life has been consumed with Betty. Most of us know that. And we're really all he has. They don't have any children. Betty could never have children. What a testimony we can be. Amen. So maybe bring him a little meal. Maybe if Nevin gets going again, maybe you could have him to your place or something. I hope we can see Nevin live on. Amen. But I love you people. Amen. Amen. What happened? Well, you're still going to. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this night. Thank you for the message. Lord, help us. Lord, I've stepped out on limbs before, but Lord, I know there's some new limbs you have for us to climb out on. Thank you, Lord, that you're a God we can trust. Thank you, Lord, that you have come through for your people before, and Lord, you're still that God today. Lord, so bless now, bless this offering. Thank you for Brother Grady giving his time, Lord, to come to this little out-of-the-way church, but preaching you, our great God. Bless the fellowship. Give us safety as we drive home. Fellas, as they go to work tomorrow, and Lord, I pray that we'd have a good night tomorrow night, a special time together. Lord, we praise you and we thank you. Bless this offering. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. See the table there. I love you folks. You have a great week. We'll keep you informed on funerals and so forth. God bless you. We love you. Have a good night.